Thank you. just realized that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Chatsworth Baptist Church. This morning, it's wonderful to see you here in the house of the Lord. We're going to start our service this morning by singing 496 in our hymn books, "We Gather Together." We'll stand together, sing all three verses.
Thank you.
Let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. Our Father, how thankful we are for your blessings upon us. We give thee praise. We've gathered as thy congregation to sing praises unto thy name this morning, to glorify thee, to exalt thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is worthy of all of our praise and adoration. And Father, to hear and heed, to obey thy word this morning. Lord, I pray that each and every aspect of this service would bring edification to your saints. And Father, if there be one here this morning who knows not Christ, would bring conviction. And Father, would convince that one of their need for the Lord Jesus Christ. May all we do and say, may our singing, our giving, our praying together, our time around your word, may each part of this service glorify thee. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Again, we welcome you this morning. It is a real joy and blessing to see each one of you here. We sort of got blown in here this morning, didn't we? Well, we're glad the wind blew you in here this morning. It's good to see you all. If you're visiting with us, we're especially glad to have you with us this morning. You are our honored guest. We're delighted to have you all with us here this morning. Let me quickly mention some of the announcements in your bulletin. Choir practice this afternoon at 4:45. And of course, choir members, we're working hard on our cantata, so please try to be here on time and ready to go at 4:45 if you can. We'd appreciate that. We look forward to that time together. And then in our evening service, we're going to begin to look at the last section that we're going to be covering, dealing with the miracles of Christ. Three instances in the Word of God where the Lord Jesus Christ raised someone from the dead. And so we're going to look at the first of those three tonight when our Lord Jesus raised the widow's son. And I think it'll be a blessing to your heart tonight at 6 o'clock. And then you'll note, now please note, our special Thanksgiving service is on Tuesday evening rather than Wednesday. Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock. And I'm going to ask you to come prepared if you can and you're willing to share a testimony and a word of thanksgiving to the Lord. Maybe you want to share a scripture that means something special to you and just share a word of thanks. We'd appreciate that. We look forward to a good time of encouragement together on Tuesday evening and pray that you do have a very blessed Thanksgiving on Thursday. Orphanage gifts are due next Sunday, so there's a basket out there on the little welcome desk in the foyer, and we'll have a name of one of the kids in the orphanage and details about needs that they have, and sizes and so on and so forth. So if you'd like to be a blessing to one of the kids in the orphanage, if you want to take one of those pieces of paper out of the basket there, and we're going to try to gather everything up and send it over to them and be a real blessing. It's always a special blessing to them, and it's a blessing to us to be a part of that ministry as well. Last chance to sign up this morning for Thanksgiving pies for the Missionary Apprentice Program, the MAP trip, 2017 to Uruguay. This is a fundraiser we're doing, and so this is the last opportunity to sign up. And if you'd like a pie, I think there's three or four different choices out there. You can sign up for that, and this would be a way you could help the young people raise money for their upcoming missions trip to Uruguay. Any questions, you could see Kim with those questions. And then you'll note your insert for all ladies of CFBC, and this is concerning the special Women's Christian Fellowship meeting, Christmas meeting, and that is December 6th. So all ladies are invited out for that. There's more information there and fun things that you'll be doing. And so if you have any questions, you could see Janice about that or Florence about that, but it'll be a good time together. Okay, those are the announcements that I have. Again, it's a real blessing to see each one of you here. We welcome you to the service for the Lord. Brother Steve will lead us in our offertory hymn.
Thank you, Pastor. 493 for our offertory hymn this morning. 493. Remain seated. We'll sing the first, the third, and the fourth. First, third, and fourth for our offertory hymn this morning.
This morning. Father, thank you for the many blessings you have blessed each one of us. Lord, surely each one of us, our cup runneth over. And so, Father, I pray that we would be cheerful givers this morning. Lord, may we be found prepared to give to you back, Lord, what you have richly given to us here this morning. Father, thank you. We love you for all that you have done for us. In Jesus' name we pray and ask. Amen.
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 Thank you.
495, we continue to sing this one, 495 in our hymn books. Count your blessings. We'll stand together and sing all three verses. The junior church will be dismissed on the second. 495.
God's amazing grace. I'm glad that salvation is not based on goodness. It's based on grace. Not our goodness, but God's grace. Not our merit, but God's mercy. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 in your Bibles this morning. We will take a little break from our study in Genesis. We'll come right back to it, Lord willing, next Sunday morning. But in thinking about Thanksgiving, I thought about this verse. Honestly, Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 20, I don't know of a greater text on Thanksgiving than this text in all of the Word of God. But I also don't know of a harder text in all of the Word of God to practice. But I want to tell you about this verse. It's the secret. It's the key to living a joy-filled, productive life as a Christian. It's the key. It's the secret. But it's not necessarily easy. Let's look at it. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 20. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Giving thanks always for all things. Now you understand why I said there's probably not a harder text than this one to practice. But oh, what a great text. And I pray the Lord uses it in my heart and all of our hearts here this morning. Let's pray. Our Lord, we ask for your help. We ask for your wisdom. We ask, Heavenly Father, that thy Holy Spirit, who is the very author of this word and who is also the teacher of it, would teach our hearts, instruct us in thy will, in thy ways, in thy word this morning. We pray, and we ask, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, if you think about it, there's really sort of four types of people, sort of four levels of people or life or living. You have those who are always grumbling and always complaining. They're not humbly grateful. They're grumbly hateful. All right? So you have those people. And then you have those who just live a life of ingratitude. They're not necessarily always grumbling and complaining, but they just don't really ever thank God. Just don't really ever thank God for all the blessings. Then you have those who do thank God for the obvious blessings. That is, when things are going well and something good happens, we're thankful. We're grateful. Thank you, Lord. Then you have this fourth level, which is the highest level, which is the Ephesians 5 and verse 20 level. Those who thank God no matter what. Those who are thankful always for all things. Now that's not easy. But when you get there, you have learned the secret of joy. Real joy. Now mark this down. Unthankful people don't really know joy. They may be happy at times based on what's going on in their lives, but unhappy people are unthankful people. And unthankful people are unhappy people. They don't really know about the joy of the Lord. They're filled many times with bitterness and with fear and with negativism and with selfishness and with self-pity. And they don't really know joy. Reminds me of a preacher who was taking a train ride. And he was sitting across from a couple. And the man was very nicely dressed and seemed to have a very kind disposition. But he noticed the lady, who was very finely dressed, was just complaining and grumbling, just griping about everything. So he thought, well, let me try to engage them in some conversation. So he said, sir, how are you? My name is so-and-so. He said, sir, what do you do? And he told the preacher what he did for a living. And he said, what does your wife do? And the husband said, well, she's in the manufacturing business. The preacher said, oh, yeah, what does she manufacture? The husband said, her own unhappiness. Her own unhappiness. I'm telling you that unthankful people, people void of gratitude to God, are miserable people. Inevitably, they are miserable people. So let's look at this verse. By the way, this is one of those verses. I could preach an entire series on this verse. This verse is loaded, but I'm just going to skim the surface of it, okay? Number one, when should we be thankful? When? Giving thanks always. Now, I thought about this. If this verse said giving thanks sometimes, it'd be so much easier, wouldn't it? Sometimes. Even if it said giving thanks most of the time, but it says giving thanks always. Always. When should we be thankful? Well, according to this verse, always. You should be thankful right now. You should be thankful later on today and tonight and tomorrow. You know, Thanksgiving's coming up. Just right around the corner. This week. But according to this verse, for believers, every day is Thanksgiving Day. Every day. Did you know today is Thanksgiving Day? It is. It is. One day is not nearly enough for all that the Lord has done for us. Every day is Thanksgiving Day. Now listen, here's why. Listen carefully to Psalm 68 and verse 19. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits. Who daily loadeth us with benefits. Even the God of our salvation. The God of our salvation, as if saving us was not enough, daily loadeth us with benefits. The fact that you were able to open your eyes, you have breath in your body, you have life today, ought to bring forth praise and thanksgiving and a heart of gratitude. Who daily loadeth us with benefits. Every day you get a fresh load of blessings. Whether you realize it, whether you recognize it or not. Every day, Lamentations 3 and verse 23, they are new every morning. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. great is thy faithfulness. And so you and I should make it our practice every day, very early in the day, ushering forth from us should come thankfulness and praises to our God. Oh, Father, thank you for breath in my body today. Thank you for health and strength and life and opportunity to serve you today. I want my lips to praise you today. I want my life to please you today. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. So Thanksgiving Day, when is it? It's today, tomorrow. It's 365 days a year. Giving thanks always, always. And of course, the most wonderful place to practice this is in our prayers. Giving thanks always. It reminded me of Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. Be careful for nothing. Don't be worried. Don't be worried about anything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. According to what we've just read, we should not be praying without thanking God. Every time we pray, it should be with thanksgiving. Now let's just ask ourselves a question. Why should God give us anything else if we're not thankful for what He's already given us? Why should He give us anything else if we haven't even thanked Him for what He's already given us? Now you listen. Nobody in here has failed to face this scenario. You've done something for someone and they weren't thankful. They didn't thank you. Didn't seem like they cared one way or another. How does that make you feel? When is the last time you just took some time and thanked God? I mean, just thanked Him for who He is and for everything that He has done for you, everything He is doing for you, everything He promises that He will do for you. Are we thankful? Are we thankful? You know what we need to do? We need to pull out some of the groans in our prayers, and we need to push in some hallelujahs. What we need to do. We're professionals at groaning, moaning and groaning. Woe is me. We need to pull out the groans, push in the hallelujahs. I tell you, you'll be surprised. Watch what happens. Begin to thank God with some heartfelt thank yous. Think about what He's done for us. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. It'll make you thankful. When should we be thankful? Always. Giving thanks always. Well, what should we be thankful for? The good things, right? Giving thanks always for all things. That's what we should be thankful for, all things. Now again, I thought about this verse. Why couldn't it have just said some things? For some things, or for most things. And by the way, if these were just my words, you need to be thankful for all things, you could just dismiss it. This is what God has told us. We're to be thankful always. That's the when. For what? For all things. That's what God tells us. What should we thank God for? Let me just give you a few examples to whet your appetite. Thank Him for your faith. Thank Him that someone told you the truth about Jesus Christ. Someone shared with you the gospel. And that you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and your sins were erased. Your sins were forgiven. You were reconciled to God. You were redeemed. You were saved unto the uttermost. And now you are a child of God. You have a mansion in glory. You're headed for heaven. Thank Him for your faith. When's the last time you thanked Him for your salvation? Thank Him for your faith. Thank Him for your Father, your Heavenly Father, who loved you so much that He gave His only begotten Son to save you. Your Heavenly Father who loved you so much that He sent not His Son into the world to condemn you, but that you through Christ could be saved. Who daily loadeth you with benefits, who's not only saved you, but sealed you and will keep you until the day of your redemption, the day you stand face to face with Jesus Christ, who's blessed you with innumerable blessings, whose thoughts toward you are more than the sand of the sea. Thank Him for your faith and your Father. Thank Him for your family. Thank Him for your mom and dad. I was thinking about this. I'm telling you, I could get on the phone right now. If I had a need, I could call my mom or my dad, and they would do whatever it took to help me. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for a mom and dad. I'm thankful for my family. I'm thankful for my wife. We should be thankful for our spouse. We should be thankful for our children that God has blessed us with. Children, we should be thankful for our parents, and yes, for our siblings. We ought to thank the Lord for our family. What a treasure. We ought to thank Him for our friends. We ought to thank Him for our friends. You know what we are? We're a family of friends. That's what we are. We're a family of friends. What a blessing to be a part of a family of friends. What a blessing to be a part of a church where we're a family of friends. We shouldn't take that for granted. We ought to be thankful for that. We ought to thank the Lord for that. We ought to thank Him for our food. And by that I just mean all the needs and necessities of life that He supplies daily. You know, if you have food to eat, you ought to be thankful. If you have fresh water to drink, you ought to be thankful. There are countries such as India where 75% of the population do not have fresh water. 2 million people every year die from water-related diseases. And we just take it for granted. But we ought to be thankful for all the daily provisions and benefits and blessings of life. We ought to be thankful for a warm house to go to and clothes on our back and shoes on our feet. We ought to be thankful for cars to drive and a beautiful place to meet. We ought to be thankful for all of these things. We ought to thank Him for our fortune. I don't care where you're at financially this morning. You are rich compared to the rest of the world. You're rich compared to the rest of the world. I mean, think about all that we have. We ought to thank Him for everything He's given to us. We're rich. But more importantly, we're rich in Jesus Christ. We're rich spiritually speaking. We ought to thank Him for our fortune. All the things God has given to us and blessed us with. We ought to thank Him for our future. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful for our future. I'm telling you, I'm not looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the upper taker. Amen? We're looking for the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the promise of his soon return. And listen, if we do go by way of the grave, you know that a Christian does not die. Christian doesn't die. To be absent from the body is to be instantaneously present with the Lord. Oh, our future. And we have a mansion in glory. We have eternal life to live with the Lord. Ought to be thankful for our future. I'm just whetting your appetite. Folks, there's no reason for us not to be thankful. There's innumerable things that we should be thankful for. When's the last time we thank the Lord for anything? Are we thankful? Giving thanks always for all things. Now quickly go back to chapter 1 with me, Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to show you why you can thank him for all things. All things. The hard things. The hard things. The difficult things. The trying things. The things that break your heart. The things that make you weep. Let me show you why we can be thankful as Christians for all things. Look at it in verse 8, Ephesians chapter 1. I want you to notice the alls with me, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to the good pleasure which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. That's why I can thank him for all things. Why can I thank him for all things? Preacher, you mean that? Yes, I mean that. That has crushed you and broken you and grieved you. Why can I thank him for that? Because it's according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his will. He has a plan, and we don't see it all, but he has a purpose, and it's a perfect purpose, and it's a perfect plan. How can I thank him for all things? Because the scripture says, and we know that all things work together for good. All things work together for. You see that little preposition for there? Well, you're not looking at it. But for, that little preposition, it means to work toward an end or a purpose. For, we're working toward an end or a purpose. He's working all things together for an end, a purpose. What is it? Good. Good. Who worketh all things together for good. For our good. To them that love God, to them who are the called according to his what? His purpose. His purpose. There is a purpose in these things. All things. Whatever has touched your life. There is a purpose. There is a plan. God is working it together for your good. There's a fable of a man who found the devil's barn with all of his seeds in it. And he began to look around that barn, and eventually he found a very large wall with many, many seeds. And he asked the devil, he said, what are all these seeds? And the devil said, oh, those are my favorite seeds. I love to plant these seeds everywhere I go. These are the seeds of discouragement. The seeds of discouragement. And oh, how I love to plant these seeds. The man said, do they always take root? Do they always sprout? He said, the vast majority of the time they do. But there's one particular type of soil that they will not take root in. They just will not sprout in it. It's the soil of thankfulness. It's the soil of gratitude. For some reason, these seeds will not sprout in a heart of gratitude. Giving thanks always for all things. Go back to Ephesians chapter 5 with me. Look at it again, verse 20. Giving thanks always for all things. Now, how can we do it? I told you, this is, I think, one of the best verses in all the Bible dealing with thanksgiving. But it's one of the hardest verses to practice. So how can we do it? How is it possible? He tells us. It's possible because of three things. They're right here. First of all, we're to give thanks by the Spirit. You can't do it. This is for Christians. You can't do this without the Holy Spirit of God. You can't do it. Now, context is always important in any passage, right? Just back up two verses and look at verse 18. You're going to see the context of this. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. There's your context. But be filled with the Spirit. Be under the influence, be under the control, be under the direction of the Holy Spirit. Speaking, here's what happens when you're under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Speaking to yourselves in psalms, the word of God, and hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks. You see it? There it is. Giving thanks is inseparably linked to being filled with the Spirit. There it is. They're inseparably linked together. If I am not thankful, hurts to say this, then I'm not filled with the Spirit of God. It's just the truth. Because when you and I are filled with the Spirit of God, when we're under the influence of the Spirit of God, we will be thankful. We will be thankful. It doesn't mean that everything's going right. It doesn't mean that our ship has come in. But it means if we're under the Spirit, the control of the Spirit of God, He is showing us and revealing to us the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's the ministry of the Holy Spirit of God. And the mark of being Spirit-filled is thankfulness. So listen, I want to, when you and I are not thankful, we're not filled with the Spirit. And I want to challenge us with that. That's the litmus test. I want you to think about it. Next time I'm grumbling, I'm going to think about this. I know I am. I'm going to think about it. And I know Jennifer will too. We're going to think about it. When we're grumbling and complaining, we're not filled with the Spirit. The mark of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit, one of the marks is gratefulness. And again, it's because the ministry of the Holy Spirit in us is to make the Lord Jesus Christ real to us. It's to remind us. It's to cause us to recognize His presence in whatever we're going through. And His promise that all things work together for good. And to remind us of His purpose that He is working all things after the counsel of His own will. And folks, we can be thankful when we understand that. We can be thankful. Christ told His disciples this in John 16, beginning in verse 12. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth. For He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come. He shall glorify Me, for He shall receive of Mine and shall show it unto you. When you are filled with the Spirit of God, you are under the influence of the Spirit of God. He will make Jesus Christ very real to you no matter what you're going through. He will remind you of the presence of Jesus Christ. He will remind you of the power of Jesus Christ, of the provision of Jesus Christ. He will remind you of the promise that He is working this for your good according to His purpose. He will remind you. That all of this is according to His purpose. He has a purpose. He has a plan. That's why I said, this is not for an unbeliever. Because what I'm talking to you about is a supernatural gratitude. Listen, I'm going to read to you supernatural gratitude. Listen to it. Giving thanks always for all things. That's supernatural gratitude. But supernatural gratitude is very possible for us. You know why? Because we have the Spirit of God in us. We have the Spirit of God in us who makes Jesus Christ real to us, who gives us supernatural power and makes Christ real to us and reminds us of Jesus Christ and His person and His presence in this hard time and His power to deliver and His promise that He's working it according to His will and His purpose for our good. He makes Christ real to us even when our world is falling apart. He reminds us of Scripture like Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Listen, here's the bottom line. When you and I are under the influence of the Spirit of God, gratitude just becomes inevitable. It's just irresistible when we're under the influence of the Spirit of God. Did you know that gratitude and grace come from the same root word? Very interesting. When we're filled with the grace of God, guess what we're going to be filled with? Gratitude. Did you know that think, and thank come from the same Greek word? Just start thinking about your blessings. Name them one by one. You'll begin to be thankful when you think on your blessings. You see, when the Spirit of God fills you with the grace of God, you will be filled with thankfulness. You will be filled with gratitude. When the Spirit of God fills you with the grace of God, you will be filled with gratitude, no matter what. No matter what may be your lot. You cannot be filled with the Spirit of God without being filled with the Son of God, without being filled with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you cannot be filled with the Lord Jesus Christ without being thankful. No matter what. No matter what. How do you give thanks? Always, for all things, you do it by the Spirit. You cannot do it any other way. You won't do it. You do it by the Spirit. And folks, listen, when we're grumbling and complaining and getting angry with the Lord for what has come into our lives and asking and questioning and accusing the Lord, we're not filled with the Spirit. We should immediately recognize, wait a minute, something is wrong. I am not right in my heart with the Lord. And I need to stop and I need to get before the Lord. And when we do that, He'll make Christ real to us. We'll be reminded of all these things, all these promises of Christ. And all of a sudden, our grumbling will turn to gratefulness. How do we do it? By the Spirit. Number two, we're to give thanks unto the Father. That's what it says in our text verse, verse 20. We're to give thanks unto the Father. Why? James chapter 1 and verse 17 says every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father. Cometh down from the Father. God is good. And listen, it is pagan. You hear me? It is pagan not to be thankful and to give thanks unto our Father. It's pagan. In fact, in Romans chapter 1, Paul is describing there pagans. And here's how he describes them. Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful. That is the mark of a pagan, is to be unthankful, ungrateful. We don't thank God. We don't give Him the praise and the thanksgiving. Do we thank Him, the one who has given us eternal life, eternal salvation, an eternal home in heaven? Do we thank the one that has delivered us from a devil's hell? Do we thank the one that gives us health and breath in our bodies and life that's so good to us and daily loads us with benefits? Are we thankful? Or are we pagan? Neither were thankful. I'm not trying to discourage you this morning. I'm trying to get us to think about it. This has hurt me. Because I need to be much more thankful. I need to be much more thankful. I hate this old flesh. Brother Greg talking about it in Sunday school this morning. What a good lesson. This old flesh is rotten. And you know what the flesh likes to do? Just grumble and complain. Funny thing about the flesh, it has a selective memory. It can remember all the bad things, doesn't remember many of the good things. And if it does, it's not thankful. Not thankful. Well, how do we give thanks? By the Spirit unto the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's how we do it. That's what our verse says. You thank Him in the name of Jesus Christ and through the mediation of the Lord Jesus Christ. We always come to the Father through the Son, through the mediation of the Son. That is to say, we are in Christ. We're in Christ. And since we're in Christ, God's Son, since we're in Christ, that means He is our Father. And that means we can come to Him and we can trust Him and we can thank Him no matter what. We can thank Him. Because you see, we're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God's Son. We are in Christ. We are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Do you know what that means? All that belongs to Christ belongs to me. Folks, I believe it, but I can't believe it. You understand what I'm saying? All that belongs to Christ belongs to us because we're in Christ and now He's our Father and every promise in the book is mine. And that's why I can thank Him no matter what. Because He reminds me every promise in the book is mine, including Romans 8:28. And so in the name of my Lord Jesus Christ, I can give thanks unto the Father. Now, you won't always understand what's going on. And I don't have time to elaborate on this. I've elaborated on it many times. But since we're talking about that, you won't always understand what's going on in your life. Hey, sometimes it will seem to you that the Lord has been cruel to you. And it reminded me of a little story I heard about a farmer. And he took his tractor and there had been a storm and he gathered up all of the brush and limbs and bushes. And he came back to burn it, get rid of it. But there was a little bird on the top of that brush pile building a nest. And so the farmer went over there and took his hand and he grabbed that nest and he took it and he tore it apart. He came back a little later and the bird was there again, building the nest again. So the farmer took his hand, he took the nest, tore it apart. This went on 3 or 4 times. And I'm sure to the bird, the farmer seemed cruel. But you know what the farmer knew? He knew that brush pile was about to be engulfed in flames. And so with a loving hand, with a hand of compassion and care and love, he took that nest and he tore it apart. I heard about a man who was shipwrecked on an island. He took what was left of the ship and he made a hut, just a crude, rough hut with what he had. One morning he went out to look for food, search for something to eat, and he saw smoke ascending. And he ran back in the little fire he had started to cook the food that he might find. The wind had caught it. It had gone ablaze and had ignited the hut. Everything he had was gone. And he said, Lord, I don't understand. Why have you forsaken me? How could you do this to me? Only about an hour later, a ship started approaching the shore. A little rowboat was dispatched, rowed to the shore. And the man on board said, we saw your signal. We saw your signal. What are you saying, preacher? Listen carefully, because this is what I'm saying. When you and I are grumbling and when we're complaining, we are grumbling and we are complaining against the hand of God. That's what we're doing. We are grumbling and we're complaining against the providence of God because He said, all things, I am working according to my purpose and I'm working for your good. I'm working for your good. And when we grumble and complain, we're basically saying, Lord, I'm sorry, but it doesn't seem like you know what you're doing this time. And we're grumbling and we're complaining against the hand of God. Listen, we don't have to understand. Here's what we have to do. We have to trust. We have to trust. Because the Bible says, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now listen, I'm done. But some of you may be thinking this morning. Now, preacher, it's easy for you to get up and say these things. You have not been through what I've been through. I understand. It's true. There's a lot of folks who have been through things that I've never been through. It's easy for you to say that, preacher. You don't know what I've been through. And you're right. I probably don't. But before we pray, could I just remind you who wrote these words? Paul wrote them. Yes, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Do you know where he was at when he wrote them? He was in prison. He was in prison. And from prison, he wrote this, giving thanks always for all things unto God. You know what happened to him in Ephesus? We're in the book of Ephesians. You know what happened to him? They lied about him. They accused him. They abused him. They mistreated him. They kicked him out of the city. That's where he was at, in prison. And from the prison cell, he wrote, giving thanks always for all things unto God. You know what? When Paul sat down to eat supper, he didn't sit down and eat like you and I will sit down and eat in just a few minutes. When he went to bed at night, he did not lie down in a bed in a warm home like you and I will tonight. And yet from that prison, he wrote these words, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Are we thankful? Are we thankful? Our Father, use your word in my heart, in each of our hearts this morning. I pray, Lord, that the message would go beyond a challenge and become a real life change in our hearts, in our lives this morning. We pray and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. 612 in your hymnals this morning. 612. Let the thanksgiving begin right now. Let it begin right now. We're going to stand up and we're going to thank God for being so good to us. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
dismiss us in prayer.